Father, we just pray that you would be with every part of the service, everything we do, that somehow it will point to you. Yes. In Jesus' name we ask these things.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Our call to worship is taken from 599, number 7 in your hymnal. Let's read this together. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart,
and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
We're going to turn to 338 in your hymnal at Calvary.
I can't, thank you.
Well, just a few words of announcements before we do get into the rest of our service. First of all, we want to remind you about birthdays and anniversaries that are coming up during the month. And Dwight Inglis had a birthday already. Donna Gary had one yesterday. So happy belated birthday to Donna. Will McCoy has one. Mario has a birthday coming up. Yeah, on the 19th. And Betty here on the 27th. And Tex and Alice have already had their anniversary. Anyway, happy birthday and happy anniversary to everyone. Tonight, in our evening fellowship hour, first of all, we get together around 5:30, and we have some good fellowship and food and sharing with one another. But then at 6 o'clock, we're going to be showing a video produced by One for Israel. And this has to do with the case for the Messiah. It is an Old Testament defense for the New Testament faith. So this messianic organization in Israel is constantly being confronted by what is called the anti-missionary group. And they are trying to say that we as Christians either misunderstand the Hebrew Old Testament or we have totally misquoted it. And so tonight we're going to be showing a video where these two gentlemen, both professors there, share, and these are both Jews who have become Messianic believers, who speak Hebrew fluently, who study the Old Testament scriptures, are going to demonstrate that no, we actually fully do understand the Hebrew Scriptures. So, the case for the Messiah. So come out tonight, very, very, very interesting presentation. Again, if you are concerned about the weather, again, we've had strange weather this year. Yesterday I did a funeral, and I came out of the funeral home. The sky was blue, the sun was shining, and it was warm. I went over by Walmart, and it was dense fog and cold and freezing. And so it's really odd. And anyway, as you know, sometimes we get snow, sometimes we get ice. So if you ever wonder whether or not we're going to have a service, call 509-301-1800, and the voice at the other end will authoritatively tell you whether or not we are still meeting. Just want to remind you that we are studying in the adult Sunday school class. We're in the book of Nehemiah right now. Fascinating study, so please join us if you can. Also, the ladies are studying the Gospel of John on Tuesdays at Patty's house. You can find out more information from her about that. On Wednesdays, there's a group that are meeting for Bible Study Fellowship. We'll give you more information if you're interested on that. On Thursdays, the ladies are meeting here, and also then the men are also meeting on Thursdays for a good time of fellowship and study and sharing, and snack for the guys. All right. If you need a ride someplace, especially, for instance, like if you have a doctor's appointment and they've told you you can't drive, either before or afterwards, give us a call, because we do have several individuals who would be more than willing to help you out with that. Operation Christmas Child. Again, we still have not established our new project for this spring yet, and so any money that does come into our coin jar has to do with the shipping costs of Operation Christmas Child. And as you take a look in your bulletin, $1,966.02 has come in to help with the shipping costs. And by the way, I am now part of a Facebook group that deals with the issue of preparing for shoeboxes throughout the year. And it's interesting how many individuals across the country are finding sales right now, like after Christmas sales or whatever. And so they're going in and buying up all sorts of small items now, thinking that this summer they'll have these items to go ahead and prepare. So if you do go shopping and find some items that you think would be perfect for Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes, talk to Debbie or one of the ladies, and they would be happy. We have a storeroom downstairs, and they're organizing everything by male and female and by age, and it'd be good to be able to get some things all ready together so that when it comes to our project later in the year, when we actually pack the boxes, we'll have items. As we pray for the peace of Jerusalem, I just want to read to you something that comes from ICEJ.org. It says, in modern times, the scattered Jewish people have returned to their ancient homeland and reestablished their nation in the face of great opposition. Their rise from the ashes of the Holocaust and return to the family of nations is nothing short of a modern-day miracle. The wonders have continued as Israel has become the startup nation, leading the world in innovation and advancement. It says, let ICEJ be your guide into the miracle of modern Israel. So if you go to their website, which is ICEJ.org, they have all sorts of links that you can link onto and learn about what God is doing in Israel today. This is a Christian organization, the International Christian Embassy of Jerusalem. And they are trying to reach out and share the love of Jesus in Israel. So be sure to link onto them. When it comes to our Alliance prayer request, please take a look at one from Indonesia. But we want to go right into our video, which is a thank you video from a young family that has a tremendous, tremendous testimony.
50 years ago, Alliance missionaries came to our grandparents in the mountains lost. We had the opportunity to grow up in Alliance Church and to now be sent by the Alliance to this region in Thailand, bringing the gospel. We saw how the Lord provided in every way.
It really felt like God has gone before us, and He has prepared a way for us.
Every church we visited, they would pray over us. We felt a sense of partnership.
We were just really humbled by the amount of love that we received from the Lions Family. We were commissioned at Council, and we moved to Thailand at the end of August 2021. We've been learning the language, adjusting to the culture, and really just trying to help our kids adapt.
In the transition, we had a lot of Alliance workers welcoming us in as if we were family as well. We're supposed to just be a language. There's really no specific ministry that we're assigned to, so we still like, hey, so how do we build a relationship? That can still be an everyday part of our life. Most of the time, we've been going out into the community, and we are intentional about trying to meet with our friends that are Thai, and working on our Thai, but also just getting deeper with them.
One of the things that we're getting
loves
is sports.
It's been a wonderful opportunity just to meet people, get the kids to be part of the ministry that we see unfolding here, and we've seen how other kids have wanted to be part of it as well.
My heart really just breaks for the people that have not heard about the gospel, knowing that all these friendly faces and smiles, behind that is just this longing of knowing your Creator.
I've had the opportunity to share my testimony with my tutor, who is our believer, and he asked me, is this story real? When he asked that, there was this part of me that just said, there's still so many people that are seeking and wanting to know why we're here and what are we doing here. And we want to just continue to say, Jesus is real and He's here. And we want to bring the gospel of Jesus to the world. Thank you, Alliance Family, for being part of our lives. We appreciate all your prayers and support.
Thank you so much for your support, your encouragement, and your love for us and our family. We really wouldn't be able to be here without you guys.
So when you give to the Great Commission Fund, it's enabling families like this that are really the gospel coming back. Missionaries 50 years ago went to Laos. And this family's family became believers, and they came to the States, and now they're going back to Southeast Asia. And so, anyway, remember that if you ever want to give a donation to the Great Commission Fund, you can do that through our offering plate, but you need to clearly label anything for missions or for the Great Commission Fund appropriately, because what we do is any money that comes in for the Great Commission Fund, we send out. We don't keep a dime of that for the local church, so. Let's go to prayer. Father God, we thank you for what you're doing around the world. And Father, we thank you for Operation Christmas Child. And even though our boxes are now sent, we thank you that we can contribute to the shipping costs. And Father, we thank you for those who are already starting to prepare for this year, already collecting items, finding sales, and buying things to pack shoeboxes for later in the year so that children around the world can hear about Jesus. Father, we pray for Israel today. And Father, we thank you for groups like ICEJ that are there on the ground sharing the love of Jesus and ministering in the midst of this modern-day miracle that we call the nation of Israel. Father, we pray for Indonesia and all of their needs right now, especially after these earthquakes and all these natural disasters, that these people would look to you. And then, Father, we would pray for Thailand. We would pray for all our new workers that are going there. And Father, trying to learn the language, learn the culture, that they might be able to share the love of Jesus for a land that has a very, very, very small Christian population. Be with us now, we pray, for it's in Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
When the Lord began his ministry, he went to the local synagogue. Isaiah chapter 61, it says, He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the captives. Jesus told him that was fulfilled in him. We're going to turn to 336, Jesus I come.
just a minute, we're going to talk about what's on the screen right now. But in the meantime, if you would open your Bible, your bulletins, we're going to take a look at some prayer requests and share a prayer time with one another. A few names that we want to add that are not in the bulletin, their current prayer requests that have just come up. One is for Richard Green. Many of you know Richard and Myrna, and they moved to Missouri. Richard's been having some issues with weakness, and they had taken him to one doctor. They didn't find anything, so it sounds like he's going to be having some more tests. So please be praying for Richard. Then for Rosa Orozco, she's a friend of some of us, and her daughters, two of her daughters, are very active in their Christian faith. One that lives in Virginia near my son Jeremy. She and her husband are kind of like lay pastors in their church. Anyway, she let me know this week that Rosa has been put on hospice. She has had cancer now for probably close to 8 years and gone through all sorts of treatment, but it sounds like this is finally coming to an end. So please be praying for her during this period of time. Then Alice Follett asked for prayer. She's going to be having some surgery on her nose, remove a growth, so please be praying for her. And then for David Mobley, this is a friend of Alice's family, not related to the Mobleys that used to be a part of our church. But anyway, David has a very serious cancer and really needs prayer at this time. I don't have any other updates on the names that are listed in the book. Do you have any updates, or are there any other prayer requests that we need to be remembering? Yes, Mark.
Steve, Donna and I would like to thank all of our brothers and sisters here in the church for all the love and support that they've given us during this time. Thank you.
Good. Very good. Okay. I'm not seeing any other hands there, so let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you for your love, and we just pray that you would continue to work in our lives, moment by moment, step by step. Father, we would pray for all of these requests that are mentioned in the bulletin, and Father, perhaps some that should be. Father, again, we know that you care about our needs more than we do, and so, Father, we just pray that you would work in such a way that all these needs will be met, and Father, that people would end up glorifying you because they've seen the hand of God at work. For it's in Jesus' name we ask these things. All right, now for what's on the screen. You'll notice, hopefully in your bulletin, there's a little hand insert put in there. And this is through the Bible reading plan for this week. This is for this Sunday through next Sunday. So I need you to help me. Okay, I'm going to confess that it's been hard for me, when I've tried before, to do a through the Bible reading plan in a year, because I'll start out real good, or I'll start and I'll stop, and I miss it, and whatever. So I thought, well, guess what? If I put it out as a challenge to the church, you're going to hold me accountable. And so I want you to hold me accountable. So anyway, Trudy and I have bought little journals, and several of you have bought them as well, and that's exciting. And it takes you through the Bible in 1 year. There's three readings a day. At this time, there's one in Genesis, one in Psalms, and one in Matthew. And then there's always a little a verse for the day, at least in this journal, a little devotional thought for the day, other spots. But even if you don't use the journal, if you just use the readings themselves, the idea is that if all of us as a congregation are reading the Bible together through a year, and then talking as we have the opportunity, sharing with one another what we've been reading, it could really change the life of our congregation. So this week, you know, we've especially been in the book of Genesis, and we've been reading about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and the covenant that God has with them, the reaffirmation of the covenant. And the thing that really has got me this last week as we've been reading is when you read about the life of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they were all scoundrels. I mean, they were not perfect by any way, shape, or form. They're lying about their wives, they're cheating them for birthright, you know, all sorts of things. And so what that says to me is, that's an encouragement. If God could love that family, and if God could use them, he could love anybody. So I think that they are a testimony of God's grace and God's faithfulness. So it ought to be an encouragement to you and to me. So I encourage you to read. If you haven't even started, no problem. Just start where we're at now. And then from next year, you can just read the little part that you've already missed, or you can go back. We haven't gotten that far. This is only 15 days into the year. And so, anyway, this is just an encouragement. It's not a legalism. It's not a requirement. But I'm just asking you to help me and keep me accountable. How's that? All right. If you have your Bibles now, please turn to the Gospel of Matthew, and we're going to continue on in our study. All right, I've got a loaded question for you. Okay? Here's the question. What does it mean to repent? Okay, now I don't expect you to give me verbal answers, but in your own mind, if you have a definition, what does it mean to repent? Now, a lot of us have various ideas. And you know, if you were to ask people on the streets, we'd probably get a lot of different answers. I'm concerned, though, that many of these answers may be partially true, or they may be partially totally false, but I don't think many of us have a full understanding of repentance, what it means to repent actually means. Well, why are we talking about this? Well, remember, we've been talking about the story of Jesus. We've talked about his birth. We've talked about the very, very early life. We've talked about John the Baptist and him going to John the Baptist, asking to be baptized, even though John didn't want to baptize Jesus because Jesus was sinless, but yet Jesus was identifying with us. We've talked about the temptation of Jesus, so-called, 40 days in the wilderness. We talked about how every time that Satan came and tried to tempt Jesus into doing something, Jesus responded with the same phrase, "It is written." He quoted the word of God back to Satan. Well, now that's over. And now in Matthew, we get to the beginning of Jesus' Galilean ministry. Now, if you read the Gospel of John, you'll find some other events that probably happened preceding this. But in the Gospel of Matthew now, and remember, Matthew's writing to Jews, and he's trying to convince them that Jesus truly is the Messiah, and that everything that happened in Jesus' life is a fulfillment of Bible prophecy. We're going to get into that this morning as well. But as a result, he gets into the beginning of this ministry. And our key verse this morning is going to be Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, where it says this, "From that time, Jesus began to preach, saying, 'Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.'" Well, the main point is all of us need to repent. So that's why we need to define what does it mean to repent. So the question that I need to ask myself, and it's going to give a little bit of a clue to you as to what repentance really means, is have I changed my mind concerning the things of God? Where is my mind in all of this? Well, two things we're going to take a look at very briefly. Fulfillment of prophecy and focus on preaching, or of preaching. Fulfillment of prophecy and focus of preaching. First of all, fulfillment of prophecy. Now again, remember, as you read through the Gospel of Matthew, and if you've been doing your Bible reading, we've had some reading in Matthew every day, and you see the calling of Matthew. Matthew was a tax collector. And remember, tax collectors were hated by their fellow Jews. The reason was they were considered traitors. They were working for the Roman government. They would set up their booth in some very, very important spot, maybe on some major trade route, and you had to stop at the tax booth. And the tax collector, a Jew, would decide how much you owed the Roman government. And you had to pay him. But the fact is, all these tax collectors were given basically a quota. You have to collect so much money every year. Anything above and beyond that is yours. That's your salary. So you know very well that many of these Jewish tax collectors were very unscrupulous men. And they were ripping the people off. But again, this way their taxes were paid to Rome. Matthew is called by Jesus. And he follows Jesus and his life totally changes. So Matthew, in a sense, is going to be an example of repentance. But what he's trying to do here is he's writing to Jews. He's trying to show that Jesus' life and ministry is the fulfillment of what the Old Testament prophets predicted. So in verse 12 of chapter 4, it says this: "Now when Jesus heard that John was put in prison, he left for Galilee." Which John? We're talking about John the Baptizer. You can call him John the Baptist, but he wasn't part of a denomination. But John the Baptizer was preaching the truth, and he was not necessarily making friends with the powers that be. And so he gets arrested. He's thrown into jail. Jesus hears about this, and his response was to move on. In verse 13, it says this: "And leaving Nazareth, he came and lived in Capernaum, which is by the sea, in the regions of Zebulun and Naphtali." Now, I know that Patty's been to Capernaum. I've been to Capernaum. Capernaum was a little fishing village right on the, what we'd say, northwest side of the Sea of Galilee. Now, the Sea of Galilee really isn't the sea. It's actually a lake. And so the Jordan River flows in at the north, flows out at the south. But the fact is that the Sea of Galilee is about 600 feet below sea level. In fact, when you approach Galilee, if you're coming from the west, you're driving down this mountain road. And as you're driving down this mountain road, as you look down and see this lake, there's a sign along the side of the road that says sea level. It's really freaky, okay? But anyway, people used to fish in that lake, including Peter and many of the other early disciples. Peter lived in Capernaum. This was the hometown of Peter. And so Jesus kind of makes this his headquarters in the Galilean region, this little village of Capernaum. We're going to be talking a lot about it as we go through the story of Jesus. But Matthew believes that even that event is an actual fulfillment of prophecy. Because in verse 14 it says this: "That what was spoken by Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled, saying," and he's actually quoting Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 and 2, where Isaiah says this: "The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, the way to the sea, beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sat in darkness saw great light, and on those who sat in the land of the shadow of death, light has dawned." So what's the significance here? Well, since you and I don't live in Israel, and we certainly don't live in the Israel of Jesus' day, it really doesn't make a lot of sense to us. So let's try to unpack this. As is his custom, Matthew sees Jesus' ministry in Galilee as a fulfillment of prophecy. Light has come to this region, largely populated by who? Gentiles, not Jews. In Isaiah 9, 1 through 2, predicted this of the ministry of the Messiah. "In despised Galilee, the place where people live in darkness," i.e., without the religious and cultic advantages of Jerusalem and Judea, "here the light has dawned." So if you can imagine this, Jerusalem was the center of Jewish worship in that day. That's where the temple was. That was the city of God. Yet if you go far north in the Sea of Galilee, that area was considered spiritual darkness. In fact, on the south end of the lake, the Sea of Galilee, is the city of Tiberias. It was a Roman city. Okay? So the Gentiles, of course, were hated by the Jews. And so they considered this to be spiritual darkness. Now, even Nazareth, where Jesus grew up, remember when he calls his disciples and they find out he's from Nazareth, they say, "Can any good thing come out of Nazareth?" In fact, later on, when Peter is at the trial of Jesus and he betrays Jesus, how do they know that Peter's a Galilean? By his accent. They talked funny, all right? Now, I don't know if you've ever traveled around the United States, but there are regional dialects. And those of us out west, we think we speak plain English. But you know, you go to some places in the country and you talk, they don't understand you. Vice versa, we don't understand them. Well, the Galileans had their own dialect, so to speak. So people look down on this region. And yet, Isaiah prophesies that the Messiah will come out of this region, that he'll be a light to this region. So Matthew, as he's writing the story of Jesus, says that when Jesus leaves Nazareth, goes to Capernaum alongside the Sea of Galilee, this is the direct fulfillment of prophecy. You know, if you take a look at the Old Testament, there are plenty of little prophecies here and there. And I equate them as to the pieces of a jigsaw puzzle. I hate jigsaw puzzles. I am no good at jigsaw puzzles. I have a 7-year-old grandson who is a genius. You can give him a jigsaw puzzle, come back a little while later, and the whole thing's put together. Okay? My brain doesn't work that way. I can put the outer edge together because they all have flat edges. But after that, the middle part, forget it. But the prophecies in the Old Testament are like pieces of the jigsaw puzzle. And when you take all these prophecies and you put them together, you get a picture. And who is the picture of? Jesus. Exactly. So, according to Matthew, this is one of the pieces of the puzzle. It is the fulfillment of prophecy. So that's the fulfillment of prophecy. Let's take a look at focus of preaching. So Jesus now begins this ministry in this large region that we call Galilee. And in verse 17 it says this, "From that time Jesus began to preach, saying, 'Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.'" Now, for those of you who have studied the Bible, even just a little, if I were to ask you about Jesus and his ministry, you probably immediately would want to talk about the miracles of Jesus. Well, he healed people. He changed water into wine. He walked on water. He calmed the waves and sea, etc. But when you actually take a look at the Gospels, that was not the primary focus of Jesus' ministry. The primary focus was preaching. Preaching. You know, as we go through the book of Matthew, we're going to see little vignettes of some of his sermons. And guess what? It's hard to read them. Why is it hard to read them? Because you're not going to like what he has to say. This is what he has to say. Challenges our lives. Challenges our preconceptions of how we should be. So what is preaching? Well, the word in Greek is kerusein, which is a word for a herald's proclamation from a king. Kerux is the Greek word for herald. And the herald was the man who brought a message direct from the king. So it is more than just teaching. It is more than just declaration. Jesus was there to announce the coming of the kingdom of God. As we go through the book of Matthew, we're going to try to unpack what that means. Sometimes the Gospels talk about the kingdom of heaven. Sometimes they talk about the kingdom of God. We're going to try to display what that means. All right. So it says that he came, he began to preach, and the very first thing it says about Jesus preaching is one word. And what is that one word? Repent. Repent. So what does it mean to repent? Well, repentance, or a form thereof, is used 74 times in the King James Version of the Bible. So it's a rather important word. It's not like this is the only time it's ever used. It's used often. Now, there's the Hebrew and there's the Greek. I am not a Hebrew scholar, and I will probably even mispronounce these Hebrew words. But think about the meaning. There are two key Hebrew words for repentance in the Old Testament, shuv and achav. Shuv means to turn back, bring back, or return. It appears over 1,000 times in the Old Testament as repent, return, restore, turn, and bring. For instance, it is translated as turn and repent in Ezekiel 14:6, which says, "Therefore say to the house of Israel, thus says the Lord your God, repent and turn away from your idols and turn away from your faces from all your abominations." The noun form of shub is shubah. It means retirement or withdrawal. It appears as repentance in Isaiah 30, verse 15. The Bible generally uses shub as a call to turn away from sin, as in 1 Kings or Ezekiel, or to return to the Lord in Jeremiah. Now, the other word is naham, which means to be sorry, console oneself, or change of mind. It occurs 128 times in the Old Testament as a change of mind, comfort, relent, and regret. It only appears as repent in Job 42:6, which says, "Therefore I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes." Now, naham is often used to express God's grief over man's sin or the relentment of his judgment. In Genesis 6:6, God, naham, regretted that he had made man on the earth. And in Exodus 32:14, he, naham, relented from the disaster he had spoken. So, the Old Testament has a concept of repentance. But what about the New Testament? Well, the New Testament was written in Greek. Now, there are two Greek words for repentance in the New Testament. Metanoia, or metanoeo, and metamelomai. Now, metanoia means a change of mind, or change of the inner man. Its verb form, metanoeo, means to change one's mind or purpose. Metanoeo comes from the Greek word meta, which means changed after being with, and noeo, which means think. Hence, metanoeo literally means to think differently afterwards or as an afterthought. Now, metamelomai means to regret or care afterwards. It comes from the Greek word meta, which means changed or being with, and melo, which means to care or be concerned. Metanoeo literally means to experience a change or concern after a change of emotion, and usually implying to regret, falling into emotional remorse afterwards. Now, what is interesting, in Matthew 4:17, our key verse, here Jesus uses a form of metanoeo, which means to change one's mind or purpose. So Jesus was about the region of Galilee. He's beginning his ministry, and as he is heralding this message from the king, he tells people to change their mind or purpose. In Mark 2:17, when Jesus heard it, he said to them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick, I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to what? Repentance." Remember, the Jews were all upset because he was eating with tax gatherers and sinners, hanging out with these ne'er-do-wells. And Jesus says, well, it's not the well people need a doctor, it's sinners that do. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 8, it says, "But beloved, do not be ignorant of this one thing, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. The Lord is not slow concerning his promise, as some count slowness, but he is patient with us, because he did not want any to perish, but all to come to what? Repentance." Why has Jesus not returned? He's waiting for you and for me. So, I put on my thinking cap this week, and I realized that is a dangerous thing to do. All right. But I tried to come up with a couple of lists to try to help at least me understand, and therefore help you understand what repentance is. So, what repentance does not mean? Okay, this is the negative. What does it not mean? Well, repentance does not mean just feeling sorry. I went to a trial one time. It was a part of a trial. Actually, two trials. And I had to be a witness in both of those trials. And eventually this person was convicted. And I'll remember that when this person was convicted, they sat and they cried. I don't think they were sorry for what they had done. I think they were sorry because they had gotten caught. They hadn't got away with it. That's not repentance. Maybe you do feel bad about what you've done, and it moves you to tears. And you even cry out to the Lord. Say, oh Lord, I'm so sorry for what I did. But that's not repentance. That is sorrow. Godly sorrow is a good thing. We should feel sorry if we've done something wrong. But that's not repentance. All right. Repentance does not mean stop doing certain things. This is the beginning of the new year. And a lot of people have New Year's resolutions. All right, this is a new year. I'm not going to, and then you can fill in the blank. How many of us end up keeping our New Year's resolutions? You know, some people think, well, you know, if I was only good enough, then maybe God could love me. Now, I know I'm doing certain things that God doesn't like, so if I stop doing those things, maybe God will love me. But that's really not repentance. Am I part of it, but it's not repentance. Repentance does not mean trying to do better or be better. You know, if I were only a better person, you know, I could be a better person if I did do these things. In other words, it's not just not doing certain things. Now, it is doing things. From now on, when I see a little old lady, I'm going to drag her across the street. Even if she doesn't want to go across the street, I'm going to help her across the street anyway. Okay? I'm going to be better. I'm going to do good things. But what makes us think that we can be good enough ever to please God? Repentance doesn't mean cleaning up your act. Okay, I'm not, you know, things really aren't very good lately. If I clean up my act, if I straighten up my life, maybe then God will love me. You know, there is a false doctrine that has become very popular today, and it's called lordship salvation. Now, do we want to make Jesus the Lord of our life? Absolutely. But do we need to make Jesus the Lord of our life so that we can be saved? No. Once we are saved, he should become the Lord of our life. But there is a preaching out there nowadays that implies, at least to people, that if they clean up their act, if they try to be really good, that then maybe God can save them. But what they do is they get the cart before the horse. So that is not repentance. So repentance is not making yourself good enough for God to love. Did you know that God loves you just as you are? The Bible says that even while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but everlasting life. We don't have to be better in order for God to love us. God already loves us. So, at least in my pea brain, that's some of the things that repentance does not mean. All right, so let's switch gears. What is repentance? What does it mean? Well, repentance does mean changing the way you think about sin. Okay? Remember the Greek word that Jesus used in Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. There's metanoeo. It means a change of mind, a change of thinking, not just a change of direction. Now, certainly, hopefully, your lives will change their direction, but it's a change of thinking, especially about sin. You know, somehow we think that there are levels of sin. I know of one particular church denomination that has a levels of sin. Some are this type of sin, some are that type of sin, or whatever. According to the Bible, sin is sin. It is falling short of the glory of God. It's falling short of God's standards. A lawbreaker is somebody who's broken the law. You don't have to break all of the laws, but if you break one law, you're a lawbreaker. If you sin once, you're a sinner. So if we truly repent, we change our mind, we understand that sin is living against God. It's being his enemy. Alright? That's the first thing. The second thing is sin is changing the way you think about Jesus. About Jesus. Many people, if you ask them today, do you believe in Jesus? Oh, yeah, I believe in Jesus. Well, what do you believe about him? He was a good teacher. He was a good religious leader. He was a moral man. He was an example. Okay, but what do you really think about Jesus? Do you believe that Jesus is God the Son, prophesied by God the Father, empowered by God the Spirit, who came and died on the cross for my sins and yours, who is buried and rose again so that we can have eternal life? Repentance means to change our mind about who Jesus is. Repentance means changing the way you think about your need for forgiveness. When I was a kid growing up, my mother was not a believer. And apparently my grandfather was not a believer. And my mother was being taken to church, and my grandfather took her aside and said, "Honey, don't worry about it. You know, someday when you stand before God, God has these big scales. And he's going to weigh your good deeds against your bad deeds. And you know, if your good deeds are more than your bad deeds, you're okay, don't worry about it." What does the Bible say? "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." What does the Bible say about our good deeds or righteousness? They're like filthy rags.
That's right.
All of us need forgiveness. Some of us need more forgiveness than others, but we all are in the same boat. It's not like there's some good people and some not so good people and some bad people. No, we're all in the same category. We all need forgiveness. So repentance means you have a change of mind. You realize, I do need to be forgiven. So, what else does it mean? Well, changing your ways under the power of the Spirit after you are saved. You know, Paul gives us two lists: the deeds of the flesh and the fruit of the Spirit. Now, if we read that list of the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, you know, wow, that's all things that I want to aspire to. But on our own, we cannot produce that stuff on a regular basis. Why? Because it is the fruit of the Spirit. We live in the flesh. What are the deeds of the flesh? Hatred, murder, all these other things. That's the flesh. And so if we want to change, we need to have God's Holy Spirit living in our life. And once we're saved and God's Spirit is living in us, then he can produce these things. So many times you've heard the illustration that it's a change of direction. So you're walking one way and you turn around and you start walking the other way. Well, that's true. But after you're a believer, we should change. Our lives should be different. Look at Matthew. Again, as I pointed out earlier, when Jesus called him, he was a hated, despised scoundrel, a traitor to his own people. He was collecting taxes. He was getting rich off his own people for their own good. But Jesus called him. He followed Jesus. He became a believer. He writes the Gospel of Matthew. As far as we know, he died a martyr's faith. For his faith in Jesus Christ. He did change his direction. But after he met Jesus, not before. So, we have the fulfillment of prophecy. We have the focus of preaching. Now, I'm not a historical expert, but I want to tell you a story about a man by the name of Alexander the Great. You ever heard of Alexander the Great? Alexander the Great was born in Macedonia, modern-day Greece. And he decided to conquer the whole known world. And he basically did. He started marching from Greece, went across. He conquered all these empires until he got to the Ganges River in India, perhaps crying because there's no more worlds to conquer. Anyway, he used to hold court. He had a big tent. And at one end of the tent was this throne. And he would sit on this throne. And people would be brought before him for trial. And he would look at them, he would listen to their story, and he would either give a thumbs up or a thumbs down. And if they got a thumbs down, they were taken out and immediately executed. But one day, he's sitting on his throne, and this very handsome, young man is brought before him. And so he was asked, what is his crime? He deserted in the face of battle. He was a coward. He ran away from the enemy. Alexander had no patience for cowardice. None whatsoever. His troops were to go forward. They were to be taking territory. They were to kill the enemy. And so just about the time he is ready to give a thumbs down to this young man, he looks at him one more time. This young, handsome guy. And so Alexander the Great says, young man, what is your name? The young man says, Alexander. Alexander the Great said, what is your name? And the young man said, Alexander. Alexander the Great thunders, what is your name? And the young man says, Alexander, sir. Alexander the Great pointed his finger at the young man and said, young man, either change your behavior or change your name. Christian. That is your name. Christian. If you know Jesus as your personal Savior and Lord, your name is Christian. If we were to stand before the Lord Jesus Christ, what would he think about our lives and our behavior? Now again, we can't repent enough in order to be saved. But once we are saved, once we know Jesus Christ as our personal Savior and Lord, is the Holy Spirit of God making a difference in our life? Are we becoming more like Jesus? Has there been a change in our thinking, a change in our lives, a change in our attitudes? Remember, salvation begins with the first change, asking Jesus to be our Savior and Lord, realizing we can't do it. The Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And so that's the first step. If you're here today and you've never had a change of mind about Jesus, a change of mind about your sin, change your mind about your life. That's the first thing, is to ask Jesus to be your Savior. Ask him to forgive you of your sins. Believe on him for eternal life. That's where it begins. But once we are Christians, once we are following Jesus, there ought to be a change of our thinking, a change in our behavior. It may not happen overnight, but we should be changing. Remember what our key verse this morning is? Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. From that time, Jesus began to preach, saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Again, the point simply is all of us need to repent. The question is, have I changed my mind concerning the things of God? Am I still trusting in my own goodness, in my own righteousness, or am I trusting in what Jesus Christ has done for me? Let's pray. As we close in prayer this morning, if you're here, maybe the Spirit of God's been speaking to your heart or your mind, and you realize that you need to do some business with God. Right now, during this quiet time, I'd encourage you to pray and talk to God about it. If you need to know Jesus as your own Savior and Lord, this is the best time to just pray and tell Jesus that you believe in him, and you're asking him to be your Savior. If you're a believer, and you realize there's some things that you need to repent of in your own life, what better time than to talk to him? Father God, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for this tremendous story of Jesus' life. Father, we thank you that Jesus truly was the Messiah, the fulfillment of prophecy. Father, we thank you that it's significant that as Jesus begins his Galilean ministry, the very first thing he says is to repent. Father, help us to understand what repentance is all about. And help us to put our faith and trust in Jesus. For it's in Jesus' name we ask these things. Before we close, we're going to turn to Dan Cogswell, will you ask God's blessing on us, please?
Oh, precious Father in heaven, it's so good for us to be reminded what true repentance means. A lot of times we try to gloss it over with some of those things that Pastor listed in his first list. I'm just going to try to do that. You know that doesn't work, Father. Father, help us to be clearly self-examining our need for true repentance, particularly as we're surrounded and often tempted to compromise with the things that go on in our society in this 21st century. Help us to live truly and only by the truth that you've given us in your word, an example of our precious Savior Jesus. Bless us now as we go our way. Bring us safely home. Bring us back if we need to tonight. Again, help us to be conscious of what that word means to truly repent. Thank you for all your words of truth. We pray these things now. In Jesus' name. Amen.